It is an understatement to say it's a thrill to be back here at the GSB. It's a particular pleasure, and I also have to admit a bit intimidating to look in the back row and see three former colleagues, Renee and Bowen, and my former associate dean David Krebs, and my former dean Bob Joss, sitting in the back row. I want to just start off by saying thank you to both Bob and Dave, who are thanked actually profusely in the acknowledgments of the book. Turnaround really is a work that grew out of, frankly, 12 years of research and teaching and interaction here at Stanford Business School. And both Bob and Dave were incredibly supportive of that research during their time here. And I remember a conversation I had, in particular with David Krebs, it must have been somewhere around 2005, 2006, where I sort of had this idea that had been kicking around in my head for a while. And I really wanted to write a book. And you know, it was one of those moments I had just gotten tenure, and you know, as an academic economist, you know, it's writing books isn't really what you do when you're in your early 30s. And David said, if you want to write a book, write a book. And I don't know how well you know David. David's not a person of many words, at least not verbally. Writing, writing is another story. Actually, if you've read his microeconomics textbook. But anyway, that push from David gave me the courage to go ahead and write this book. So I just want to say a special thanks to Bob and to David for their leadership and their encouragement over the years. So thank you. Turnaround is really driven by a couple of observations. And if you go back with me in time, just a few months to January of this year, there was a narrative that was emerging. And the narrative was the late 2000s were the period of emerging markets. And post-financial crisis, and in particular, in a post-quantitative easing world, in a world of tapering that was really setting in and was going to be solidified with Janet Yellen coming on board as chairman of the Fed, the emerging markets age was over. Advanced economies were resurgent, and we were entering a different era. And what I want to argue is that's really a false narrative, and it's in many ways a zero-sum narrative. It's a narrative that basically implies that the rise of emerging markets in the early 2000s and the late 1990s was in many ways at odds with the prosperity of advanced economies. And it also, frankly, misses the point, which is that we're in the midst of an economic recovery, which is, by most measures, a very tepid economic recovery. Potential GDP in the United States is still about 10% below where it would have been had we not had the Great Recession, had we continued growing a trend. The world economy, if you go back to 2007, grew at 4.9%. This year, we're scheduled to grow at 3.6%. Advanced economies are scheduled to grow at roughly 2.2%. this year. And so even with the United States forecast to grow at roughly 2.8%, that's just barely a trend and not fast enough to really make a significant dent in the persistent unemployment problem that we have. It's true unemployment has come down substantially, but if you look more carefully at those numbers, you realize that unemployment is down in large part because of a drop in labor force participation. So this is not to say that things haven't gotten better. But by most measures, the United States economy and the world economy and advanced economies as a group are still performing below expectations, below potential. And very importantly, this false narrative really misses the bigger point. And the bigger point, in fact, I think arguably the largest the most important economic story of the last 50 years is the remarkable turnaround that happened in countries that were formerly known as third world countries, now known as emerging markets, over the course of really the last three decades. So just to give you a sense of this, from 1980 to 1992, the economies that are classified as developed and emerging economies by the IMF grew by about 3.4% per year. that had average inflation rates during that period of about 50%. From 1992 through 2013, so even if you include the last 6 years or so of less than stellar growth, these countries have grown by 5.4% per year. So they've increased their growth rates by 2 percentage points. Just to give you a sense of why that matters, for a country that increases its growth rate by 2 percentage points from 3.4% to 5.4%, living standards in a country that goes from that growth rate of 3.4% to 5.4%, living standards, when you grow at 3.4%, double every 29 years, roughly. When you go at 5.4%, living standards double every 16 years. So this has real impact on people's lives in developing countries. And quite importantly, when emerging markets grow more rapidly, they raise demand for exports and products that are produced by advanced economies. And so again, this is not a zero-sum game. And so the message I want to leave you with today is to reject that false narrative that the last 10 years were the decade of emerging economies, and now all of a sudden emerging economies are fading in the background, and it's a resurgence of advanced economies. The reality is we need to learn the lessons of the last 3.5 decades of how it is that emerging economies, or formerly third world countries, transformed themselves into emerging economies, the emerging economies of today, and take those lessons to heart in order to continue to see rapid growth in emerging economies, and just as importantly, for advanced economies to start living up to their potential again. And those three lessons, in a nutshell, the lessons that we learn from the story, the history of the emerging markets, are quite simple. They can be summarized in three words: discipline, clarity, and trust. Through discipline, clarity, and trust, these economies were able to turn themselves around. Now, I'm not saying all emerging economies have turned themselves around. There are lots of countries that haven't. So what I want to do today is just explain to you what I mean by discipline, clarity, and trust, and illustrate those principles with a few stories from countries that were able to transform themselves from third world countries to emerging markets, and argue that these basic principles are very much applicable in advanced economies today. All right, so first point, discipline does not mean fiscal austerity. Discipline doesn't mean the willingness to adopt strict or necessarily harsh policies. Discipline means a sustained commitment to what Bob's predecessor here at the business school, Mike Spence, would call a pragmatic growth strategy. So a sustained commitment to a pragmatic growth strategy that is both vigilant and flexible and values what's good for the country as a whole over what's good for any individual, interest group, or person running for political office. In other words, discipline means having a strategy, a long-term strategy, but being flexible about the tactics that get you to that destination. And I'll give some examples of what discipline is and what discipline isn't, particularly in a fiscal context. Second point, clarity. Third world countries turned themselves around once their leaders demonstrated a clear commitment to a change of direction. And the combination of discipline and clarity produces trust. Trust in domestic constituents, domestic stakeholders. Some people might even say that business moves at the speed of trust. Markets are deeply dependent on trust. And what I want to argue, as I come to my third point, is that for all the talk about deficits that there's been over the course of the last 3 or 4 years, post-financial crisis, in many ways, the biggest deficit, the deficit that really threatens joint prosperity between emerging and advanced economies in the future, is what I call the trust deficit. There's an incredible mistrust between advanced economies and emerging economies, to say nothing of the mistrust that exists between many domestic constituents and their governments. Okay? So with my remaining time, and I want to make sure I leave plenty of time for questions, let me share a few stories from Turnaround that I think illustrate the principles of discipline, clarity, and trust at work. Okay, so to begin the discussion, the first thing you've got to recognize is that starting in 1982, August of 1982 to be specific, countries that were then known as third world countries ran into great difficulty servicing their debt. So in August of 1982, August 12th, I think specifically, Mexico declared that it could no longer service its debt. And that triggered something which is known as the third world debt crisis. And the third world debt crisis took on great international significance because much like we were worried in 2008 about systemic risk to the financial system as a result of the failure of large U.S. banks, the inability of Mexico and then subsequently countries like Brazil to service their debt put the international financial system at risk. And the third world debt crisis also coincided with tightening of U.S. monetary policy, worldwide recession, and as of 1985, even as advanced economies were recovering, third world countries were deeply mired in debt, and there was fear that the entire decade would be lost. So in October of 1985, then Secretary of the United States Treasury, James A. Baker III, goes to Seoul, South Korea, for the annual World Bank IMF meetings, and he presents a speech. He presents a speech that he had been working on over the previous several months, and had been kind of ironing out over breakfast with Paul Volcker over that spring. And Baker's speech was called A Program for Sustained Growth. And in this speech, Baker basically outlined what he felt, what the United States Treasury, by proxy, his boss, President Reagan, and the entire international financial community felt that these third world countries needed to do in order to start growing again and to be able to service their debt. And very specifically, it was a program that countries needed to follow in order to receive funding from the International Monetary Fund to be able to service their debt and the World Bank in order to restructure their economies. So in Baker's program for sustained growth, he outlined, broadly speaking, what was viewed as good economic policy. So he basically argued that countries need to open their economies to free trade, they needed to reduce their fiscal deficits, they needed to be more open to foreign investment. They needed to privatize state-owned enterprises. And he went through a long list of items that later became known as something called the Washington Consensus, quote unquote. So to put it mildly, Baker's speech was not well received in the developing world. This was basically seen as an attempt by the United States government to impose their hegemony on newly independent countries throughout Latin America, Africa, and Asia. And leaders and citizens in the third world felt that this program for sustained growth, this so-called Washington Consensus, was in no one's interest except the banks. So this set off a firestorm. And the reason why I'm telling you all this is because you have to ask the question, what does discipline mean? Does discipline mean following the set of policies that were outlined by Baker in that program for sustained growth, or does it mean something else? And for all the uproar that Baker's speech caused, I would argue that in many ways, the controversy over whether the Washington Consensus, a set of policies on that list, were helpful or harmful to emerging economies was as controversial today as it was then. So if you were to talk to, let's pick two not so random economists. Pick Joe Stiglitz, former chief economist at the World Bank, and ask him, was the Washington Consensus helpful or harmful to developing countries? He would give you a tirade as to why the Washington Consensus was not in the interest of developing countries. If you would ask Ann Kruger, another former Stanford colleague who was the number two person at the IMF, she would argue that, in fact, the Washington Consensus was very helpful. And where countries didn't see improvements in economic policy, they didn't see improvements in economic policy not because the Washington Consensus failed, but because they didn't try hard enough to implement the policies on the agenda. And so the question then becomes, if there is this deep ideological disagreement about what discipline actually means, how do we resolve this? How do we figure out what discipline policy actually looks like? Because it matters, because going back to those numbers I quoted you before about growth, people's lives are at stake. So what I do in turnaround is to argue that if you want to know what is likely to help or hurt a country's economic growth, don't listen to what Joe Stiglitz says or what Ann Kruger says. Look at the historical data and look at how stock markets in these countries responded when their governments decided to implement policies that were on that list of items that Baker said would help countries grow. In other words, the stock market's forward-looking. All the stock market cares about is whether policies are likely to create value or destroy value. Are cash flows, future cash flows, going to be higher or lower? What's this going to do to discount rates, interest rates, and risk premium? And so, very simply, and there's a lot of detail in the book, which you can follow, and if it's not enough detail for you, you can go back to the articles that which the book is based. But basically, by looking at how country stock markets responded to various changes in economic policy, we can discern whether, in fact, policies are likely to create or destroy value. And the good news is there's a lot of data, because a lot of countries went through a lot of economic reforms. Now, one question you're probably thinking about is, well, why the stock market? What about behavioral economics? Isn't the stock market irrational sometimes? The short answer is yes. The stock market isn't always spot on. But all you need to believe in order to think that the stock market is something useful to say about the likely future impact of economic policy is that the stock market responds to new information. In other words, the prices don't have to be exactly right. But if the direction of the price change is consistent with whether policies are likely to create or destroy value, then it can be quite useful. And in particular, we don't want to look at how the stock market responds in any one particular episode. We want to look at many, many episodes across many countries over time to see, on average, what does the stock market think, for instance, about fiscal discipline or fiscal austerity in particular. Okay? So the stock market is going to be the key tool for understanding what discipline means. So having given you just this, a flavor of why I think the stock market is a useful tool, let me tell you what the stock market finds in the case of fiscal austerity. Because I made the claim that discipline doesn't mean fiscal austerity. Okay, so how do I know that? I know that because if we actually look at the data, there are 81 episodes historically from roughly 1976 through the mid-1990s of developing countries implementing fiscal austerity, most of the time under the auspices of IMF programs. And those 81 episodes of fiscal austerity are administered under different conditions. And the central finding is that when countries are suffering from high inflation and they implement fiscal austerity, and the connection between high inflation and fiscal policy is really quite simple. When governments run large budget deficits, they tend to finance those deficits by printing money. If those of you who've taken E300 will know the connection. When countries implement fiscal austerity in the midst of high inflation, and there are roughly 25 episodes of that, the stock market responds extremely positively. So in the year leading up to the implementation of fiscal austerity in the midst of high inflation, abnormal returns in the stock market are about 60% in real dollar terms. That means the stock market goes up about 60% more than it would have in the absence of the austerity program. Okay, so value creating. In the 56 episodes where inflation, and by high inflation, the threshold is actually quite high here. It's about 40%. And that 40%, I won't talk about where that comes from, but it's basically based on some studies that were done by Stan Fisher and Bill Easterly. So below that 40% threshold, And the average is roughly in that moderate inflation category is about 20% per year. So think roughly the kind of inflation that we saw in places like Chile in the late 1980s. When inflation is moderate and countries implement fiscal austerity, the stock market actually declines by about 30% in the year leading up to the implementation of the program. So this is very clear divide. And the stock market is telling us that fiscal austerity implemented in the midst of modern inflation seems to be value destroying. So what I take from that, looking at advanced economies, it seems quite clear that in the world that we just emerged from, in which you saw inflation rates of 1 or 2% in Europe, 3% or so in the United States, administering or driving policies of fiscal austerity in that environment, if we had taken the time to actually look back at how the stock market had responded historically in the cases of these developing countries, I think we might have reached different conclusions. So what does fiscal discipline mean? Fiscal discipline doesn't mean fiscal austerity. What does it mean? Fiscal discipline is really more complicated than it is in E300 or your standard textbook. Fiscal discipline means running countercyclical fiscal policy. All that means is really no more complicated than the story of the ant and the grasshopper in Aesop's fables. When times are good, the economy is booming, you save, so that when times are more difficult and the economy is in a recession, you have a cushion, a surplus, to actually spend. And an illustration of this is really what I call the story of kind of the first world ant, the first world grasshopper and the third world ant. So the first world ant, the first world grasshopper, is the United States. So in 1999, the United States ran a record fiscal surplus, roughly $232 billion, if I remember correctly. It's in the book. And the following year, we had another record surplus. And then we had an election. And when George W. Bush became president, he said, we're going to return the people's money. The fiscal surplus belongs to the people. So we had a tax cut. And subsequently, we had September 11th and a series of wars, unexpected shocks, fiscal shocks, shocks that required fiscal expenditure. And we then had a series of deficits that got us to a point where we didn't have a surplus when we actually needed to spend. And so we had really large deficits during the financial crisis. And this set off a firestorm of debate over sequestration and so on. Now, I want to be very clear. I'm not making a partisan point here. Because you could argue that had we had a different outcome in the 2000 election, had Gore become president, we would have still seen fiscal deficits, just in the form of higher spending instead of lower taxes. So it's not a partisan point. The point is about a lack of discipline, the lack of willingness to save when times are good so you can have a cushion when times are bad. And Chile, in the early 2000s or the mid-2000s, is an example of a third world country actually being disciplined. So in 2006, Chile had a $6 billion surplus. Actually, not a $6 billion surplus, but $6 billion of revenue sitting in the treasury. And if you can think back to 2006, that was a time of booming commodity prices. Copper in particular was booming. Copper is Chile's main export. And by 2008, that $6 billion surplus had grown to $50 billion cushion. And so Andrés Velasco, who was finance minister at the time, was burned in effigy in the streets of Chile because the students and workers wanted him to give the people their money back. They wanted to share in the good times. And Velasco said, no, this is money for a rainy day. When the financial crisis hit, Chile was able to institute a $4 billion tax cut package, which really cushioned the blow of the financial crisis. So that's what discipline means in the context of fiscal policy. The stock market tells us that, and there's some good examples, like Chile and the United States, of discipline at work in the case of Chile, less so in the case of the United States. All right, so clarity. I made the claim that countries, third world countries, the ones that were able to right themselves, did so once their leaders demonstrated a clear commitment to a change of direction. So I think the best example of clarity comes from a very small island, an even smaller island than the island of Jamaica where I come from, the island of Barbados. All right, so most people only think about Barbados in the context of going on vacation, but there's some really interesting economic lessons to be learned from Barbados. All right, so in 1991, Barbados was on the verge of financial meltdown. You might recall there was a savings loan crisis in the United States. There was a credit crunch in the early 90s. The U.S. went into a minor recession. But when the U.S. has a minor recession, Caribbean economies tend to get pneumonia from this cold the United States has because they're so dependent on tourism. And Barbados was no different. So Barbados was about to run out of foreign exchange reserves. And so the IMF flies into Barbados and meets with the local officials and says to them, you've been running a fixed exchange rate vis-a-vis the United States. The Barbadian dollar was fixed to the US dollar, 1.7 Barbadian dollars to the US dollar since the early 1970s. And the IMF said, you're basically becoming an uncompetitive economy. Simply put, because of the value of the Barbadian dollar, vacations are too expensive. The Barbadian dollar is overvalued. You become less competitive. Wages have risen too quickly. You need to devalue the currency. Interestingly, the Barbadian official said, no, we don't want to do that. So that, actually, that part's not that interesting. Most countries typically say that when the IMF comes in and tells them to devalue. What's interesting about Barbados relative to most countries, is they actually came up with an alternative plan. They said, we're not going to devalue the currency because we like having a fixed exchange rate. It helps us fight inflation because we import a lot of things like cars and cornflakes. If we devalue the currency, that's going to set off a wage spiral because people are going to see that their cornflakes are more expensive and their cars are more expensive. They're going to ask for higher wages, and it's going to set off a wage price spiral. Instead, we propose to cut wages, cut public sector wages, by roughly somewhere between 8 and 10%. Because cutting wages will have the same impact as devaluing the currency. It's all about reducing our unit labor costs. So the Prime Minister, Erskine Sandiford, and officials from the Ministry of Finance convene three-party talks between the private sector, the government, and the labor unions. So as you can imagine, no one really likes having their wages cut. Dave Krebs knows that very well. The faculty are particularly thrilled by having their wages cut, nor is anybody else. So these talks were really contentious. But the officials basically said, it's either a wage cut or a devaluation. So you pick, Sol or Charybdis. And by a small margin, the workers voted to accept the wage cut. And as of October 1991, this became the official policy. There was going to be a wage cut. And so 30,000 people took to the streets of Bridgetown, Barbados. Now, 30,000 doesn't sound like a lot, except when the country's only 250,000 people. It's 12% of the population. So this is, it's not exactly analogous, but see, it's roughly equivalent to 36 million people marching on Washington in protest of their wages being cut. So this is a society that's about to come apart at the seams. Leroy Trotman, Sir Leroy Trotman, who was head of the labor unions, to his everlasting credit, he actually goes to the unions and says, this has to stop. We're gonna pull the country apart. So he gets called several not so nice names by his constituents, but he's able to reconvene the three-party talks. And so, interestingly, the private sector all of a sudden gets a lot more serious because hotel owners don't like it very much when people are marching in the streets because tourists don't like that either. So they come to the table in a more serious way, and they agree to open, the private sector agrees to open their books to the unions, and they come to an agreement that any future wage increases will be based on productivity gains to keep costs from getting out of line with productivity. They agree to the 9% wage cut, and so the center holds. I mean, the church has to get involved in negotiations. It's a very ugly dispute. It goes all the way to the Privy Council in England, but the center holds in this thing. The stock market goes on a tear after Barbados is able to come to this agreement. and the economy recovers in a year's time. Now, Erskine Sandiford, for his trouble, was actually voted out of office, his party. And in fact, Sandiford would never again be prime minister, and his party was out of power for 14 years. When asked in retrospect, did you pay too high a price? Sandiford's response is very simple. The price I paid was a small price to save Barbados. That's clarity. So last point I'll make, and then I want to open it up to questions. I made the claim that discipline and clarity produce trust. By exercising discipline and clarity, a number, not all, but many formerly third world countries have been able to turn their economies around and achieve unprecedented levels of growth and have become the emerging markets that are still, in fact, driving global growth. They account for now almost 50% of global GDP and more than two-thirds of global growth. But in spite of this fact, what we see in the context of international relations, so now go back to the world of Baker and the IMF and the World Bank and the World Trade Organization and those key international institutions that set the economic policy agenda for all countries. In those circles, the emerging markets, in spite of the turnaround that they've engineered, have yet to be recognized by advanced economies for the gains that they've made. So let me give you some specific examples. So the five largest emerging economies, the so-called BRICS, now account for roughly 21% of global GDP. But if you ask, well, what fraction of the votes do they have at the institutions of the World Bank and the IMF, at the board, where key decisions get made about the global economy, it's only 11%. In contrast, the countries of the euro area, which account for about 24% of global GDP, have roughly 32.5% of the votes at the IMF board. So in spite of these gains that have happened, there hasn't been a commensurate rebalancing of power at these institutions. And in particular, in 2009 in Pittsburgh at the G20 summit, global leaders agreed to reform the IMF, that two board seats at the IMF would shift from the advanced economies of Europe to the emerging markets. But this hasn't happened. This has been agreed upon. In fact, the G20 finance ministers and central bank governors have voted on this, have approved this. But this is still being held up by the US Congress. Another example, the G7 countries, who are supposed to be the gatekeepers of global trade and the key drivers of a free trade agenda. When the world financial crisis hit in 2008, made a strong pledge to maintain free trade and maintain open markets. In the aftermath of the financial crisis, there was a spike in trade and sort of anti-free trade measures. Turns out that roughly 40% of those discriminatory trade measures were instigated by G7 countries. In fact, if you actually look at, there's recently a paper published by the Center for Economic Policy Research, CEPR, C-E-P-R, not CEPR across the street, but CEPR is in London. It showed that the four most protectionist economies in the world, four of the top 10 most protectionist economies in the world were the United Kingdom, France, Germany, and Italy. Kind of striking. So between the creeping policies of protectionism that have ensued in the aftermath of the financial crisis, and the unwillingness of the United States in particular, but advanced economies in general, to embrace reform at the IMF and the World Bank, we're now in an environment in which there's increasing mistrust between emerging economies and advanced economies. And you might say, so what? Why does it matter? Well, it matters because the ability of leaders in developing countries to drive through what I would argue is a continuation of the reform agenda that they began in the post-Baker era, a reform agenda that really drove them from 3.4% growth on average to 5.4%. The ability to continue to drive that agenda is not unrelated to the extent to which they can say to their domestic constituencies, we've achieved a different level of status with the advanced nations who pushed this reform agenda on us in the first place. So this lack of reciprocation undermines the ability of leaders to continue to push through the hard reforms, the discipline and the clarity that are needed to drive growth in their countries, and by the way, to drive growth worldwide as well. So if you think about the change that needs to happen, continued change that needs to happen in the emerging world, this is a pretty important point. So just to wrap up then, the turnaround that's happened in emerging economies or third world countries over the last several decades has really important lessons for advanced nations. We're seeing tepid growth at best in advanced economies. Europe is still very stagnant. The jury's out on Abenomics in Japan. The United States is getting back on track, but we have structural work we need to do as well. And I would argue that if we could have the humility to actually look back on what happened in countries that, frankly, we advised, we sort of gave them the playbook as to how to change their economies, but now we're ignoring our own advice in many respects. If we have the humility to go back and look at these lessons, I think there's a more prosperous future for all of us. And the final point I will make is that over that same period of time that I quoted before, from 1982 to 2013, I quoted the numbers for the turnaround in growth in the emerging economies. Between 1982 and 1990 versus 1982 versus 1992 to 2013 in those emerging economies. If you ask the question, this is just to underscore the point that growth is not a zero-sum game, what happened to the growth rates of advanced economies over that period? And the answer is absolutely nothing. They stayed the same. In other words, the rise of emerging markets did nothing to undercut the growth of advanced economies. So growth is not a zero-sum game. The rise of emerging markets doesn't come at the expense of advanced economies. And in fact, it's the growth rates of emerging economies during the financial crisis that kept the recession in advanced economies from being even deeper. So our futures are indeed tied together ever more closely. And if we can just simply learn the lessons of discipline, clarity, and trust, again, I think there's a brighter future for all countries. So with that, let me stop and take any questions. Thank you for attention. Yes?
You mentioned the stock market's a really good indicator of value creation. During that time frame, to what extent did the fixed income markets also indicate value creation? I know that fixed income markets are, when times are really bad, they tend to, you know, rates will go down for quite to quality. But then when value is being created, you would think that rates would go down, and that would also be a harbinger of good times come as well. So there's a correlation as well.
Yeah, it's a great question. So I spent the better part of my, probably my first 7 years at Stanford Business School trying to track down data on bond yields in emerging economies during the very turbulent times. And the short answer is I found it next to impossible to put together a time series, largely because of the high inflation in these countries during the late 70s and early 80s, there wasn't much of a bond market at all. And so the only data that exists are very, very infrequent data on the price of syndicated loans. And it was so infrequent as to not be very helpful. So the short answer is I don't have. I would love to have had the bond yield data, and for these countries during this time period, but I don't. But your insight is exactly right, and we can indirectly infer. I mean, because your question is really one about the cost of capital, right? And just to give you a sense of the the change that occurred. In 19, let me get the date right. In 1984, if you looked at the price earnings ratio in Latin American markets, take the average of PE in Latin American markets, it was 3.5. Okay? So that's not a mistake. So just take the inverse of that, which is the earnings price ratio, right? You got the average, the cost of capital, which is about 28%. So the cost of capital in Latin America, the cost of equity capital, which incorporates obviously a risk premium above and beyond, you know, the risk-free rate, which you can take roughly as a fixed income yield, was 28%. And that was a major obstacle, obviously, to investment and growth. And it was largely driven by the fact that they were closed to foreign investment, so there was a shortage of capital, but also there was great uncertainty about the future, as indicated through high risk premium. And what's really extraordinary, actually, is if you actually ask the question, what were stock returns in Latin America versus Asia over the period from 1976 through the mid-1990s? So Asia grew over that period probably three times as fast as Latin America, had single-digit inflation. Latin America grew probably maybe 2.4% over that period and had very high inflation. But Latin American markets over that period vastly outperformed Asian stock markets. The returns were twice as high. And the reason is because of the resolution of uncertainty that occurred as a result of the reforms in Latin America. So the price earnings ratio in Latin America goes from 3.5 in 1984 to 14. It's sort of a new steady state by the mid-1990s. And so what happens, so I'm giving you a much longer answer to your question than you wanted, but it illustrates your point about risk premium and yields. So what happens in Latin America, the price earnings ratio goes from 3.5 to 14. Because you think about, again, think about the price earnings ratio. The inverse of that is just the earnings yield, which is basically your cost of equity capital, which incorporates risk and the availability of capital. And so as a result of opening up the economy, getting in more capital, and reducing the variance of future cash flows, basically uncertainty about the future, by reforming the economy, risk premium go down. And so you get a repricing of the assets, right? So you're going from a higher cost of capital to a lower cost of capital. But in addition to moving to that new higher equilibrium price earnings ratio, earnings are also growing faster because the economies are now performing better because of the reforms. And so prices have to grow even faster to keep up with earnings. And so it's through this double effect of basically moving to a higher multiple and prices growing more quickly to keep up with more rapid earnings that you get this incredible performance in Latin America relative to Asia over that period. And as I argue in the book, this is all, again, largely due to the reforms and the turnaround that happened in economic policy.
So I'm pretty interested. You're talking about the great change that's taking place in the emerging market over the third decade. So I'm curious, what's on your mind? What is the biggest challenge that the emerging market they're facing, and what is the biggest lesson they should learn from developing?
The emerging markets should learn from developed countries.
Yeah. So, what's the biggest challenge they're facing?
I think the challenge, you know, varies across countries.
I don't think it's homogeneous. China financial reform is really central. Making sure that the banking system allocates capital more efficiently. What I would like to see in that context is the U.S.-China economic dialogue. Continue to focus less on the exchange rate and more on the long-term structural reforms that need to happen in China, the banking system in particular, but also the social safety net, because as China tries to move itself to a consumption-driven model as opposed to an investment-driven model, what's going to be really key is, one of the things which will be really key is reducing precautionary savings. And in order to want people to consume more, they have to feel less uncertain about the future. And improving the social safety net is going to be key to that, as well as allocating capital more efficiently. In other countries, in Brazil, infrastructure is a major bottleneck. So the challenges in Brazil are, I think, are very different than they are in China. So there's no one challenge, but I would say one common thread that runs through all of the emerging economies. One example of the mistrust that I talked about is the fact that the so-called BRICS have now set up their own development bank. And while I have no objection to countries thinking about independent institutions, it's the spirit in which that was set up. In other words, the frustration with the exclusion or seeming exclusion from the process in a meaningful way that led to that. I think that's a dangerous kind of slippery slope towards more balkanization amongst institutions, international institutions. And so, just to make the point, I think the one common thread that runs through emerging markets is that they have got to accept if they want to play a bigger role in global affairs, they have to speak with a more consistent voice and a more responsible voice, right? Because I think with greater authority comes greater responsibility. And I think that emerging markets, if you think about the kind of disorganization that they showed amongst themselves when vacancies came open at both the World Bank and the IMF, I think that's indicative of kind of a lack of kind of consistent voice. And so I think their biggest kind of single challenge, even though they have their own individual country challenges, is how to speak with one responsible voice in spite of that heterogeneity that they have. Yeah. Yes.
So in your anecdotes, you illustrated a tension, which is that discipline and clarity don't seem to be politically popular, whether it's the PM getting voted out or creating a surplus and then the next administration spending it. So how would you redesign the system so that there's an alignment in those incentives?
Yeah, so
this is sort of a cop-out answer, but this book is really trying to define the what. The next book will be about how. I mean, it's the right question. I mean, it's very humbling, right? I mean, other than being lucky and getting a good leader like Stanford, I'm not sure that we know a lot about how to make this happen in democracy. I mean, the hopeful note that I will strike on this is that there are examples of democracies that deliver on this. It goes in cycles. Brazil in the early 90s, in 1990, as late as 1992, Brazil had the world's highest inflation rate. Nobody would have bet in Brazil in 1992 that they would have had the two decades they had going through Lula's last term. Now Brazil has challenges again. So discipline, has a cyclical component to it. But Brazil, even Indonesia. I mean, Indonesia under Suharto during the Asian crisis, I don't think anyone would bet that Indonesia is going to be a democracy, again, with many challenges, but a Muslim democracy with a reasonably well-functioning economy that was growing as of 5 years ago. Again, Indonesia has many challenges with a large current account deficit. But I think Indonesia is surprised a lot of people. So there are examples of democracies that actually do deliver good policy. But as to how to create a system that does it more systematically and doesn't just require luck, I have to think about that for a while. I thought there was, yes, over here.
So what is or was your advice for President Obama about implementing, that discipline in the context of America right now, right? With sort of not in a recession, but, GDP growth is very low, labor force participation is low, but the stock market is booming, right?
Yeah.
So what fiscal discipline look like?
So I think the big kind of discipline question facing the United States right now is not so much about fiscal policy per se,
as it is, I think we're now having this kind of untethered debate about income inequality, which I think is actually a little dangerous in the following sense. So I've not yet read the Piketty book on capital. I intend to read it. But there's now kind of this backlash against capital. And one of the ironic lessons that comes out of the work is the stock market, which is in some ways the ultimate symbol of the wealthy, is an incredible barometer for forecasting what's going to be good for the poor. Right. So when the cost of capital goes down, oh, the gentleman who asked the question is no longer here, that induces firms to invest. When firms invest, workers become more productive. When the workers become more productive, demand for labor rises, their wages go up. So if we want to think about, if we want to address income inequality in the United States in a sustainable way, we shouldn't, in my view, we shouldn't be arguing about the minimum wage. I mean, you could have a legitimate discussion about the minimum wage. It's, I think it's probably 20% below in real terms where it was when Ronald Reagan was president. But that's not the real issue in some sense. The real issue for generating sustained prosperity amongst the working class and reducing income inequality, we know this from the work of people like Larry Katz and Claudia Golden, is increasing the number of highly educated workers in the workforce, because it's the combination of technology and globalization that have increased the demand for folks in this room, high-skilled workers, that's really driven wage inequality. So if you want to sustainably reduce wage inequality, you've got to get more people going. You've got to get more people into four-year universities, and we can also talk about vocational training and other kinds of skills. But that's the real discussion. And so discipline in the context of income inequality means having a responsible discussion about how to invest in upgrading the skills of the workforce and taking it out of the debate of, you know, the 1% versus the 99%, which in my view is getting into a realm of kind of, frankly, kind of populist discussion that has shades of, you know, my home country, Jamaica, in the 1970s. Michael Manley became prime minister. And if I encourage you to read nothing else in the book, read chapter two on policy matters. Michael Manley came to power in Jamaica in the early 1970s on a platform that said he was going to unify the country. And he won with a landslide with roughly 60% of the business class supporting him. Because in their view, Manley was going to be what I would call, you know, in retrospect, a Lula-style populist who is going to have rhetoric that unified the country and motivated and inspired the poor, but actually implemented disciplined economic policy. And instead, what they got under Manley was someone who had a very positive social agenda, but completely ignored the market. And so, by the time Manley left office, Manley was in power for 8 years. When he first came into office, the stock market took off because they viewed him as basically bringing in social peace, right? So you can think of this as basically a guy who's going to kind of reduce uncertainty about the future. By the time Manley left office, the stock market had lost 90% of its value. Investment as a fraction of GDP had gone from about 17% per year to something like 10% of GDP. And there was massive unemployment, and Jamaica's never really recovered. So I'm not saying the United States is going to be like Jamaica, but I'm saying this you know, there's we're in an environment now where people are talking about income inequality, you know, bashing capitalism and saying, you know, capital, you know, the wealth accumulation is bad. So I just think we need to remember that if we want to sustainably, there are no examples of countries sustainably lifting people out of poverty by just redistributing income. You've got to grow the pie. And you don't grow the pie by bashing business.
We have time for about one more very big question.
Yes.
I don't have time, so just a really quick question. You mentioned that stock market as forecast of the impact of policies. Are you assuming that the stock markets are efficient to price in the impact of the policies? But for emerging market, you can easily argue that the stock market are not efficient.
Yeah. So I thought about that question a lot. While sitting at Stanford Business School and looked at a lot of data on this. So here's the key thing, and I think we've kind of reached kind of a healthy balance now with the Nobel Prize going to both, you know, Shiller and Fama, and also Hansen at Chicago. sort of a, you know, markets are efficient in the following sense. I mean, there are many types of market views of the efficient markets hypothesis. You don't need to have a strong form efficiency view which says that the stock prices are always spot on and always and immediately reflect all relevant information. There are some people that believe that. I'm not one of many. You don't need to believe that in order to recognize that when you actually just look at the data in emerging markets. So this is the thing that I learned by spending, you know, the better part of my youth looking at these data. Even in markets that are not that well capitalized, where a relatively small fraction of GDP is straight out of the market, it turns out when money's at stake, people respond to information. And that's sort of the big insight of efficient markets. And it turns out that insight holds in the data, even in countries where the stock market is not nearly as developed as it is in the United States, or even as it is in Brazil. And so what you see, and in particular, I talk about this in the book, we have to understand is these are not small kind of revisions of earnings that are happening in these countries. These are huge tectonic shifts in economic policy with big implications for discount rates and cash flows. And what you see is that the market, lo and behold, you know, when money's at stake, prices respond. People trade on the information about the future of the economy. So let me just tie your question into the question that was asked over here about discipline. So I think the big message is it's not that you believe you need to be in strong form efficiency. Markets price information. They price information about economic policy. And because policies that generate value in the future or perceive to generate value in the future drive up stock market valuations, they also create conditions in which businesses have a greater incentive to invest in real capital. And investment in real capital, again, this is an empirical statement, not theory, is actually good for workers. And I'll just end with a specific example. When emerging economies open their stock markets to foreign investment, not only do stock prices go up permanently as a result of liberalizing, the real take-home pay of workers in the manufacturing sector also increases as well. And I think the numbers were something like the average take-home pay of workers over a five-year period post-liberalization goes up by about I'm trying to remember numbers off the top of my head, but their real take-home pay increases by about a fourth. So there's a substantial increase in their standard of living as well. So in other words, again, it's not a zero-sum game, right? Policies that are good for shareholders are also in many cases good for workers. And this doesn't mean that there's no role for government, but going back to the question of, you know, are the policies that were outlined in the original Washington Consensus good or bad for emerging economies? Is discipline good or bad for emerging economies? And is it good for all countries? Discipline, as I defined it earlier, the stock market says, by and large, yeah, that's the case. So I'll stop there. Thank you for your attention.